know, I forgot the games came out after 2002.
Remember Kingdom Hearts 3? You know, that game from 10 months ago that everyone hated because it didn't cure their back pain and pay their rent? Well, it cured my back pain and paid my rent, so I love it. But really, I think the least controversial take about this game is that it is certainly the most controversial game in the series. And I think it was kind of inevitable. Well, first off, I want to dispel with this fiction that people had waited 14 years for this game. If you were waiting 14 years, I don't think you were paying too much attention. At most, I think it's fair to say you waited 6 to 7 years. Dream Drop released in 2012, followed by the first KH3 teaser in 2013. When people ignore the series from 2006 to 2019, I assume they don't actually care that much, and I'm not that surprised when those same people are confused by whatever's going on. 6 to 7 years is still a considerable amount of time, don't get me wrong, but this 14-year talking point is a lot like the 14th member of the organization. It shouldn't have existed in the first place. Point is, you have not been staring at a blank wall ever since you beat KH2 waiting for KH3 to release, or at least I hope you haven't, but I feel like some critics probably did. You had a bunch of games release in the meantime, and I don't think any meet the caliber of the numbered 3, but one comes close, a few were solid, and the rest were definitely purchasable. And I'll let you decide which ones fit those descriptions. Pet peeve about the numbers aside, 6 to 7 years is still a long wait, and that's a long time for expectations to run rampant. I had literal dreams about playing this game, or more frequently, having the game in hand but waking up before I could play it. And I would wake up very sad, both because it wasn't real, but mostly because that's what my subconscious was dreaming about. You would think, given how much anticipation I felt and how much mental energy I devoted toward waiting for this game, that it was a massive disappointment for me, just like it was for any true blue, pessimistic Killjoy Kingdom Hearts fan with access to www.twitter.com. But no, I thought it was lovely. Some might misconstrue that as denial or fanboyism, and I can assure you this is not the case. I have watched the final season of Game of Thrones. I have played Recoded. I am perfectly capable of feeling let down by something that I had a lot of hype for and more than willing to critique an entry in one of my favorite series. And listen, if you were disappointed by KH3, if you have issues with it, that's cool. I've got issues with it too, I wish some things were done differently. To bring it back to numbers, maybe some people just weigh certain cons more heavily than I do. If I'm evaluating any game and starting with it as a 10 out of 10 and taking points off for the negatives, maybe you're taking off more points for things that I would only deduct a small amount for. For example, the lack of Final Fantasy characters is a head-scratcher for sure, but that's maybe a quarter of a point off for me. If that tanks it for you, fair enough, it doesn't for me. Regardless, there are certainly many fair critiques to be made about KH3, and that's all this is really about. I think some critiques are unfair though, ranging from misguided to made in bad faith. This video is going to focus on story and especially pacing, something I think KH3 catches a lot of flack for, which amuses me considering it exists in the same universe as Kingdom Hearts 2, whose story many people seem to regard as flawless, I think because they must have developed amnesia and forgotten about 75% of it. I'm not really going to touch on other aspects of KH3 here, like combat, which I am more understanding about the gripes with, or world design, which I will likely never understand most of the gripes with. Let me start out by opening a concession stand here. I'm handing out drinks and snacks, and also admitting that this game does things wrong. Hopefully that'll convince any doubters that I've not been paid by Square Enix to shill for this game, although I would certainly sell out and do that if they did. I have always found ideals don't take the place of meals. That being said, let me briefly list 5 major story issues that I tend to agree with most critics on. I won't spend too much time hammering home why these things are bad because the internet has already done that plenty, so I would just be echoing popular sentiment. And I just said something spicy about KH2, so clearly I'm not in the business of doing that. Unless paid to. So, those issues. Why are we visiting Disney Worlds? KH1 and 2 were much clearer about this. We're searching for people and locking keyholes. The best we do in 3 is going to Olympus in the beginning so Sora can get his strength back. If we could have just a small reason like that for each world, however superficial, it would have been miles better than just, I don't know, exploring to kill time. You could say that Sora is trying to discover and learn the power of waking, which brings me to my next concession, the power of waking. Yeah, I don't get it, or maybe I do get it, and I'm just really underwhelmed by it. I feel like this could have easily been something that Sora actually does discover and learn throughout his journey in this game, instead of just realizing he had it all along in a crucial moment. Like, it was there the whole time is almost too Kingdom Heartsy for even Kingdom Hearts. Well, actually, they also kind of did it before, in 2002, with Kairi. Which brings me to my next concession, Kairi. boy, we were sold a bill of goods with this girl. You know, she's never been terribly depthy or complex. She makes someone typically easy to unpack like Sora seem extremely nuanced by comparison. Kairi has spent the series as only 25% human girl and 75% MacGuffin, but we were at least being teased with this idea that she would really come into her own and be a true force to be reckoned with ever since those final hours of Cage 2. And those chickens just never came home to roost. Who would win? A princess with an incorruptible soul who trained in a hyperbolic time chamber with a wizard and Quentin Flynn, or the dark voodoo art of just grabbing you by the wrist? Gotcha. The time travel thing in the Keyblade graveyard. I love the final world, I love Donald v. Terranort, I love all of that. I don't understand what's going on with this going back in time sequence, and it's unclear how aware or unaware certain characters are of this all having happened already. It's one of my least favorite parts of the game, and I honestly don't even want to spend any more time on it because it's just a headache. And lastly, no definitive middle point. This one bothers me the least, but in a video where I'm going to compare the pacing of 3 and 2, I cannot ignore that 2 blows 3 out of the water in this regard by way of the second trip to Hollow Bastion and all of the plot revelations that take place there. The middle is arguably the best part of Cage 2, one of the 3 really good parts, one of the 3 parts where anything cool and significant happens. One of the 3. Yeah, so if I didn't just hit you over the head hard enough with my feelings about how Cage 2 paces itself out, let me just transition into my defensive stance now. Okay, people hate the Disney worlds in Cage 3. Waste of time, all of its filler, nothing happens in this game till the end. I hear that a lot. I can be pretty agreeable to the notion that the Disney worlds in basically every Kingdom Hearts game are filler, or at least not as impactful as the original worlds. I think every entry, even Cage 1, could have improved on that, but this is all to be expected to a degree. It's already a miracle that these games exist just on a corporate level, so I'm not shocked when the game's heaviest plot points are taking place as far away as possible from Disney's patron saint and personal Khaleesi, Queen Elsa. Here's my big issue with this notion. It's only natural for us to compare 3 to 2. In fact, most of this video is going to operate under this comparison because it's something that people have done a lot of in the aftermath of 3's release. We're comparing the latest numbered console entry with the one that came before it. Makes sense. But there is a very vocal chunk of this series fanbase who will deride Cage 3's pacing and its non-original worlds, and then suggest in the same breath that Cage 2 did it any better. And in some aspects, it did, as noted before. You know, reasons to visit the Disney worlds, solid middle point, all of that. But are we being willfully ignorant of how much of a slog Cage 2 can be at times? How are you so angry about nothing important happening in the Cage 3 Disney worlds? I mean, did you play Cage 2? Like, I think we all went into this game knowing that the big, thick plot stuff was going to happen outside of the Disney worlds. I'd be interested to know where someone may have gotten the idea that KH3's Disney worlds were going to be a masterful synthesis of overarching plot and Disney stuff interwoven with each other flawlessly throughout the game. You certainly didn't get that idea from Cage 2. I mean, in a perfect world, I would have loved a bit more cohesion as far as the story goes, but I had been conditioned by prior games in the series to not expect that. Is that an excuse? No, but it's an explanation. The first 3/4 of Kingdom Hearts games have always been runways to varying degrees, and when we think back on big moments from each game, we think of moments set in Hollow Bastion or a world that never was. When you think back to the first time you rode a plane, I'm sure you probably think of being airborne more so than speeding on down that fillery runway. KH2 happens to have a layover, but for the most part, that's just what this series does. Let's fulfill our contractual obligation of doing Disney stuff, which, mind you, I think is leaps and bounds more charming than it was in 2, and get to the meat of the game. And as much as we all sit around and groan about having to get through Disney worlds to get to the plot in any of these games, let's not forget that that was the hook for so many of us originally. You showed up for the Disney and stayed for everything else. Now surely you understood that it was going to be a big part of this third installment, just as it's always been. Even knowing that these games have a history of front-loading and back-loading important stuff, I still put KH3 into my PS4 excited to see movies from my childhood like Toy Story and Monsters, Inc. given the Kingdom Hearts treatment. If there wasn't at least some of that same excitement there for you going into it, I can more easily understand your frustrations, but I would also question why you have no soul and can't just enjoy running around beating up bad guys with frickin' Buzz and Woody. I'm only being slightly facetious. Here's the thing though, I've kind of been playing devil's advocate here, at least when I entertain the notion that the majority of KH3 is filler. My truest reaction is to reject that notion. Again, if you want to talk about the worst filler world the numbered titles have to offer, I'm going to point you to KH2. Well, and Arendelle, I'll concede that too. That was mind-numbing. But in fact, my bigger issue with KH2's filler problem is less so the world, and more so what happens in between them, aka nothing. Like, here's how I see it. On first playthrough, KH2's pacing is a lot more agreeable because you don't really know what's going to happen. obviously, you haven't beaten it yet. Something could pop up any minute now, you can't be certain. KH1, as I've highlighted in my world rankings, had moments in Disney worlds like Monstro and Neverland that actually pushed pieces forward in the plot, so you were on guard for moments like these in KH2. These moments don't really come, but you are probably swept up in the grandeur of Twilight Town and Hollow Bastion and World That Never Was to really reflect too deeply on all of that pesky middle stuff. I know I was. I played through KH2 a good few times over and over after it initially came out when I was a kid, and it was my favorite back then. I think by 2008 though, my disc wasn't working anymore, so I never really played it again until the 2.5 remix came out. Once I got to playing through it again, I realized, wait a minute, I don't want to do like any of this? Well, not any, but most of this. I had played the KH1 remix a year prior, and at the time it was my less preferred of the two, but I never found myself wanting to skip cutscenes or rush through worlds. But on this revisit of KH2, it was a battle of willpower to not press start and cut through the self-concerned, self-contained Disney bullshit and rush through these worlds to get to the best parts of the game. And god, those parts are so good, those parts go a ridiculously long way in making KH2 one of my favorite games, but I could not ignore the boredom I felt when running through Land of Dragons to Pride Lands. And that goes for both trips, to be honest, but especially the first round because they're longer, or at least they feel that way. KH2 for me is saved by it being so fun to play and its Disney cutscenes being skippable, otherwise I would have zero motivation to ever touch it again. So you know what I really appreciate about KH3? It gives me something to nibble on. It keeps me motivated to keep playing, because when I finish a Disney World, I'm not just immediately spit out and thrown into the next one. This is the huge thing that really sticks in my craw when people are drawing comparisons from 2 to 3. I am so goddamn bored on a replay of KH2, and I've mentioned this before, but even as a kid, despite being unsure of how things were gonna go, I slowly came to understand the pattern on my first playthrough. You go to a Disney World, then you do a Disney World, and then another, and then another. You needed to have big, floppy shoes on the ground in an original world if you wanted to see any meaningful stuff. But in KH3, after beating a Disney World, the game rewards you with scenes of relevant activity, or at the very least, you're getting to see characters who actually matter. I've heard and read how people just rush through the game to get to the important stuff at the end. I mean, I beat the game pretty quickly too, but that's how it goes with any game with a story I'm really invested in. I tend to play through as quickly as possible because I want to know what happens, but I still enjoy the ride and take everything in as I go, you know, gotta smell those roses. But did these people just not care about these interlude cutscenes? Like, did you rush through those too, or go to the bathroom when they were on? If anything, yeah, watching these made me want to keep playing and get to the end of the game because it motivated me to keep playing. I want to see more of these scenes. I want to know where it's all going. Like, we get this scene of the classic organization members talking in their little makeshift throne room here. It's just in the middle of the game, just thrown in there. You mean to tell me that this was filler, that you were just rushing past this stuff just to get to those bosses at the end? I was like yelling at my TV when the scene was playing. I was just so excited to see and know more. You never get anything like this in KH2. You want to know your reward for beating Land of Dragons? Beast Castle. So, despite not having great reasons to visit Disney Worlds, despite the Power of Waking being a bunch of malarkey, I'm like 20 times more tapped in on both the initial and subsequent playthroughs of KH3. Now, squabble with how the plot points themselves are executed all you want, in fact, I'll likely be right alongside you doing a fair share of squabbling, but I really think KH3 does a much better job at feeding me consequential and genuinely interesting material on a far more consistent and merciful schedule. At the very least, it's giving me something to look at. Like, maybe I'm easy to please in that way, but it goes such a long way for me after coming off of a game that just gives you nothing for hours and hours at a time. KH2 does give me 3 good meals, but like, goddamn, dude, let me have a snack every now and then. You can't stop my stomach from rumbling by telling me how good lunch is gonna be. You're just making me hangry. Now, just to further illustrate my point, because I think some people subconsciously block out that like 3/4 of KH2 is uninterrupted Disney World shenanigans, let me visually plot out how often each game pulls back the curtain on non-Disney story elements. For this exercise here, I took a look at 2 long plays of both games, one for KH2 from a channel called Much Games, and one for KH3 from the channel Rabid Retrospect Games. I just chose these two because they weren't 100% runs and they include all of the gameplay and cutscenes. That is to say, I wanted to look at these two completely ordinary playthroughs and take note of when the aforementioned moments of interest pop up and plot them onto a timeline. Let's take a look at KH2 first, with this playthrough clocking in at roughly 25 hours and 3 minutes. This playthrough does deal with Hundred Acre Wood in Atlantica, and I kept those in, but I did, however, subtract any time time spent playing Olympus Cups. Overall, that doesn't really matter. The main point of the exercise here is to make note of any time the game throws us a bone with any content of actual consequence, i.e. non-Disney filler. Excluding the optional worlds doesn't really make it look that much different, for better or worse. The main effect of this choice here is that this playthrough does the majority of the 100 Acre Wood stuff after the second visit to Space Paranoids, so there's a bit of a gap between that and the final Twilight Town visit, whereas in reality, those two events can happen much closer together. Okay, let me box in the parts of Cage 2 that I have no problem with. As stated ad nauseum now, beginning, middle, and end. I will admit that I forgot that Cage 2 does at least give us a bit of interesting stuff with Axel and Kairi after Agrabah here, although if the player wanted, they could forego the remaining Disney worlds and just head to Twilight Town immediately after those scenes, if I'm not mistaken. But yeah, everything in these red boxes I regard as peak Cage 2 stuff. I love everything going on here. The game has my full attention. This is meat and potatoes. It's these yellow bracketed parts here where I'm just getting nothing from the game. Here's what I'm rushing through to get to the good stuff. Here's what I think are some of the most egregious acts of filler in the series. I was even being generous by throwing the Disney Castle Timeless River point in there. It's an appreciated shakeup, but it's not exactly of utmost importance. If Cage 2 gave me anything in these big multi-hour chunks, anything at all, I would have noted it down here, and it just doesn't. You know, let us check in with the organization, like something, anything. Unfortunately, it's just rapid-fire Disney worlds one after another during these bracketed portions. In comparison, here's my timeline of Cage 3. This playthrough took about 21 hours with these players taking care of 100 Acre Wood after their last major Disney World, so in between those magenta and light blue bubbles. Now, again, minus that middle point, Cage 3 also has a concentration of relatively important and noteworthy stuff going on in those beginning and ending portions boxed in pink and purple here. I've included these beginning and ending events on both timelines mainly as a formality and for completion's sake, because I'm really more concerned with comparing the middle of both games with this exercise, and as I mentioned earlier, I'm a lot happier with the much steadier supply of even slightly interesting scenes during the Cage 3 mid-game stretch. Again, maybe you don't like what it all built up to, maybe you wanted more out of them, but man, at least it gave me something neat for my eyeballs to look at on a regular basis. Now, those five bubbles in the middle all come after completing one of the main Disney worlds, and they went a long way in keeping me motivated to keep playing. Seeing Vexen slinking around and not being 100% sure what angle he's playing, watching Haner come in with a steel chair trying to kick Ansem's ass, Aqua trying to protect Ansem the Wise in the Dark World, these moments all had me pumped up, and they're all happening in spots where you'd just be flying your gummy ship over to Halloween Town or Agrabah if you were playing Cage 2. So it's going to come down to preference, as it always does, but if I have to choose between having that big epic middle point within a desert of disinterest or a couple of moments of intrigue scattered about that middle stretch, I'm always going to pick the latter because it does a much better job at holding my attention. I would have loved to have had both, and a common suggestion is maybe bailing out Aqua and Ven right around the middle point, and I can't really complain or argue with that idea, but I would very much like to do away with this notion that Cage 3 is all filler until the end, or that it should have more closely followed what Cage 2 did, because it very should not have, minus a more definitive middle. If you ask me, of course, feel free to disagree, not that I have to request that. Now, throughout this comparison exercise, you might have noticed that I've been ignoring the actual Disney worlds themselves, and I've done that because I think it's easier to talk about them separately. Because sometimes, things do in fact happen in these Disney worlds, people show up, like characters that would have Walt Disney rolling over in his grave, you know, the characters who matter. It happens in both games, and to varying success. In Cage 2, we get Zaldan in Beast Castle on both visits, Demix in Olympus Coliseum 1, Zigbar and Riku in Land of Dragons 2, and Luxord in Port Royal 2. But that's it. And half of these occasions don't make too much sense to me. I mean, Demix in the Underworld gives us a bit of a Roxas tease, but otherwise, I feel like it could have been anyone else filling his place in this spot, organization or not. I have no idea what Zigbar is doing in Land of Dragons. Luxord and Port Royal I kind of get, there's that sort of gambler-slash-pirate-code connection, so okay. Zaldan in Beast Castle I think is the best integration that Cage 2 sees, even though they totally should have saved Marluxia for that spot just for the Rose connection. But Zaldan at least has a clear goal and motivation for being here, and it does feel like you're at least chipping away at the organization when you take him out on your second visit. Now in contrast, every Disney World in Cage 3, sans 100 Acre Wood, has a member of the true organization show up, and more often than not, it makes thematic sense for that specific character to be there. Once again, I think it's fair to say the why here might be weaker, but the who, where, and when are much stronger. Sora can't clash with any of these organization members before the Keyblade War starts. Those are just the rules, but I knew that, and I truly wasn't expecting to fight any organization members until we got to the graveyard. I'm not bothered by having no battles with them in these Disney worlds. I am sort of finding it hard to pin down exactly what some of these organization members are doing then if we can't fight yet, particularly in worlds that aren't home to one of the new Seven Hearts. In those cases, it makes sense that Marluxia and Larxene would be scouting out Corona and Arendelle respectively, as they want to keep an eye out for potential replacements for the Seven Lights. But I don't know why Sora is being bothered by young Xehanort in Toy Box or Dark Riku in San Francisco. And yeah, Dark Riku, I won't even try to defend that one. Worst member of the group by far, big, big WTF. The only real reasoning given for these two is that they're conducting experiments on either toys or data respectively, but like, why, guys? The Keyblade War is like a few hours from now. What good are any of these experiments when we're gonna be having a fight to the death before supper? Those two members are the bigger misses, but I think only by process of elimination, because I love how the other organization members are utilized in this game. First off, we've got Uncle Ziggy in Olympus, and his visit here makes a lot more sense when you know that Uncle Ziggy isn't really Uncle Ziggy. He's just here to mess with Sora, but also sort of encourage him, and that makes more sense given the man's ulterior motives. If you're gonna do this in one of the Disney worlds, do it in the very first one, if only to give the player time to forget about how cryptic Zigbar is in this spot so they can more easily be shocked by the big reveal later on. Next we have Marluxia in Kingdom of Corona, and I think he's a great pick for this spot because the parallels between Chain of Memories and Tangled practically draw themselves, and that's draw like the kind of drawing that Naminé does. Remember when Marluxia had Naminé, a young girl with powers, locked up and kept away from the outside world? Sort of like when Mother Gothel had Rapunzel, a young girl with powers, locked up and kept away from the outside world. Plus they even found a movie with a bunch of flower symbolism for Marluxia to hang out in this time. Next up, as for Larxene, if you're gonna put her somewhere, it only makes sense for the only woman in the organization to show up in the Disney world that's based on a movie that so prominently features two strong female protagonists. Or so I'm told, at least. I haven't seen Frozen. But I played KH3, so I feel like I pretty much have, right? Won't defend the singing here either. But yeah, natural spot for Larxene to work the girl power angle. Now, Luxord is pretty much in the Caribbean because it was the world he was deployed in KH2, so he's the most familiar with it. It's not aggressively good or bad that he's here, but it makes sense if only because of the precedent set in 2. And you know, I'll even cut Dark Riku a bit of slack for at least showing up in a world that also features a dark version of one of its protagonists. Like, if we're gonna send Dark Riku somewhere, I guess it should be here. So really, the candidate for Toy Box is the true leftover spot, and I guess they just put young Xehanort here because, well, he's a form of Xehanort, and we should probably see the man himself in at least some capacity before the graveyard. But you may have noticed I skipped over Monstropolis, and that's because I wanted to save what I view as the best for last. Vanitas was, like, made for Monstropolis. It's such a natural combination. This is what I point to when people say KH3 didn't make any attempt to weave Kingdom Hearts original stuff with the Disney worlds, because this is the most natural it's felt, to me at least, since KH1. This sort of cohesion is never present in KH2. Having Vanitas, a character who's been so heavily associated with negative emotions, pop up in a world where the screams of children were once harvested for energy, a Disney world, mind you, is brilliant. And people are gonna say nothing of consequence happens in any of these worlds. Vanitas is literally resurrected due to the qualities of this world, so I don't know what more you could ask of a world like Monstropolis. What more were you hoping for? Like, how much more should the streams cross? Like, did you expect Sully to just say, "I've had enough of this shit," and body Vanitas? Because that's never gonna— what is that? Oh yeah, it did happen. That did happen. Exactly that happened.
Vanitas, Vanitas.
And that's another thing. The Disney characters feel a lot more involved with these original villains. They're given more time to interact with each other. As I said, I like how Zaldan and Beast are handled in KH2, and KH3 has a few occasions of Disney characters going toe-to-toe with these organization members, like Pirate Breath in the Caribbean, or Woody reading young Xehanort for filth and telling them that he's going to die a virgin. You're probably saying, "I don't remember that part," but that's because I have the only Final Mix copy, and that's the only change. But yeah, remember that part in KH2 when Belle elbows Zaldan and takes the rose? Everyone likes that scene because it's equal parts awesome and absurd, which is what this series is. And allow me to speak for everyone when I say we all like those aforementioned moments in KH3 as well, because characters from two different sources are getting to not just coexist, but interact, which is, again, the bread and butter of the Kingdom Hearts series. This has gone on longer than I anticipated, so we'll start to wind it down here. Now, I see KH3 get some flack for its Disney worlds just following the plot of their respective movie. In reality, it's really only three that do this, and I think to generalize that all seven do is a bit disingenuous. The main three culprits here are the Caribbean, Arendelle, and Kingdom of Corona, as these worlds have moments that are practically ripped from the films, most notoriously in Arendelle, of course. The other four make an effort to deviate away from their movie's plots enough to be considered an original story, if you ask me at least. Doing the movie plot itis is an affliction especially strong in these three worlds, stronger than it is in any game, but it's really confined to those three occasions. KH2, while it lacks a world that is so dramatically undergoing doing the movie plot itis, suffers from symptoms throughout a majority of its worlds. In fairness, the second visits are a bit more original, albeit shorter, but I would only regard Space Paranoids, Olympus Coliseum, Beast Castle, and to a degree Halloween Town as original stories. Granted, KH2 has more worlds than three, but it's a victim of doing the movie plot itis on more occasions. These worlds in question are practically practically retellings of The Little Mermaid, The Lion King, Pirates 1, Mulan, and Return of Jafar. I've said this before in another video, but I would just watch the Disney movies if I wanted to see them. And I said that before Disney Plus came out, so now it's even easier. I swear I'm not being paid for anything. Anyway, Kingdom Hearts 1 is really the only game that's basically entirely immune to doing the movie plot-itis, which is on record as my favorite, so I'm not really excusing either 2 or 3 for falling into this trap, but again, I'm just providing a defense for 3 in a spot where people conveniently forget the reality of 2. Okay, last point, and a fairly quick one because it's kind of cut and dry. This is less an argument or comparison and more like a what-if scenario. I think KH3 would have benefited tremendously from less revealing marketing. I can't be certain, and I can only speak off of anecdotal evidence and my personal experience, but I wouldn't be surprised if people were underwhelmed by certain developments in this game because they went into it knowing these things would happen by way of seeing these things in trailers and teasers. I mean, let's go back to 2012 really quick. For years after the end of Dream Drop Distance, the big discussion in the community was who are the 13 Darknesses. In hindsight, I would have loved to have gone into KH3 a bit more blind to these answers. Seeing Larxene, Marluxia, and Luxord in trailers really dampened what would have otherwise been a bigger reaction for me had I just run into them during the game. The same goes for other key moments like Anti-Aqua in the Dark World or anything regarding Scala or the Final World. I get that you want people excited, but this is Kingdom Hearts 3, you know, you've already got us. Just show us early game stuff and all of that Disney filler that everyone loves so much. We're still gonna buy the game if you don't show us those big characters. An exciting trailer is fun, but I would want people to come away from the game itself feeling that excitement. The game itself should ideally overshadow any memories or emotions that come from watching a trailer. Alright, hopefully I haven't managed to provoke any airstrikes from anything I've said here. Honestly, this was pretty cathartic for me because I've had thoughts on Kingdom Hearts 3 and especially the wave of criticism it's received for months now, and I've been wanting to put my organized thoughts on the record for a while. For the sake of insurance, I'll restate, I am a big fan of all of these games and I'm only trying to be fair in my critiques of all of them. If you still dislike 3 or think it's the weakest in the series, that's fine. I just hope some of the points I've brought up made you think about the nature of general consensus as it pertains to discussion of the game, especially when it's compared to other entries. You might agree wholeheartedly with everything I've said, and 2 is still the best in your eyes, and I would completely understand. Like I said early on, the pros may outweigh the cons for you, and maybe the cons don't weigh very much at all. Regardless, I've been itching to provide my explanation for why I prefer KH3 as an experience over KH2, and if that means I need to be put to death, so be it, I guess. If dying means I get to hang out here, I guess that's not so bad. As always, thanks for watching, guys. The take that I'm arguing here is apparently so hot it's liable to burn your eyes and ears off, so I'm very impressed by anyone who made it this far. This was supposed to come out a good while sooner, and I won't lie, I got distracted by Pokemon Sword, another game that's seen a very controversial release. And to prove that I'm not just being contrarian for the sake of it, I'll say, yeah, I agree with a lot of the problems people have with it. Not one of my favorites. Still fun enough, but could have been much more. That's something I've heard people say about KH3 before, funnily enough. Well, different strokes for different folks. Nothing specific planned for the future, story of my life, but I'm sure something will be coming out one way or another. Alright, that's all for me. Big blue thumb, red button, happy Pat.
What? You gonna go? This is goodbye?